I'm going to tell you God's will. Paul is going to tell you God's will. This is the will of God. Your sanctification. What situation are you working through right now? What difficulty are you facing? What challenge are you concerned about? What question have you figured and figured and figured, but you haven't come up with the answer yet? What in the world does God want in this situation? Your sanctification. That's what He wants. Sometimes God is not concerned as much about the decision that we make as how we make it. The kind of person that we are. He says, this is the will of God, your sanctification. That is, and then He gets specific, that you abstain from sexual immorality. That each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor. Not in lustful passion, like the Gentiles who do not know God. And that no man transgress and defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things. Just as we also told you before and solemnly warned you. For God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in what? Sanctification. So, he who rejects this is not rejecting man, but the God who gives his Holy Spirit to you. Now, as to the love of the brethren, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. For indeed, you do practice it toward all the brethren who are in all Macedonia, but we urge you, brethren, to excel still more, and to make it your ambition to lead a quiet life and attend to your own business and work with your hands just as we commanded you, so that you will behave properly toward outsiders and not be in any need. All right, we're looking around today and we're a group of pretty much all believers. We have made professions of faith in Christ, and so it's appropriate that we come to a passage like this, because this is talking in very practical terms to believers. This is talking to Christians. Now, I've shared with you before my philosophy of ministry. I believe the church is primarily for believers. Now, the fact is, that doesn't mean we shouldn't be trying to bring people that don't know the Lord to church. And I want to encourage you that every time there is a person here who doesn't know Christ, I hope that I will very clearly communicate, and you can be assured that it is my goal to communicate clearly the gospel of Christ, that salvation is through faith alone. But you know what? Most of the New Testament is addressed to believers. And so it's appropriate that as we come to God's Word, we realize this is for us. So don't think this is for somebody else. This is for us. Now, the problem with this passage is that it very clearly communicates that as Paul talks to the Thessalonians, he's building on a prior relationship. He's already been to this place. He's met these people, most of them. Now, they're probably new believers that he's never met, but he has taught them, and he has intended. Whenever Paul went and he'd start a church somewhere, he'd leave somebody behind to continue teaching them. That's what he did with Timothy. That's what he did with Luke at different times. He would leave somebody, and they would continue teaching the church. And so he refers several times to, I've already told you this. And guess what? I've already told you some of this stuff. But do you ever need to be reminded?
Yes.
Okay? I need to be reminded. He's saying, I've told you, and in fact, he repeats a couple things here. I've told you this, and he says, you're doing a good job. Now, not every church that Paul wrote to was doing a good job. Any church come to mind that wasn't doing a good job?
The Corinthians.
I mean, the Corinthians had problem after problem after problem. But here, this church is one that Paul can address in a very positive way. They're doing a good job, but he says this. He says, you're doing a good job, but what? Do even better. Keep getting better. Keep excelling. Keep improving. Keep growing. And so here's this theme. However, even though he says this, he says something very, very significant that I want to emphasize, and it's right there in your title. Read the title to me.
Simplicity and sanctification.
Simplicity and sanctification. How many of you know what simplicity means?
Keep it simple.
Keep it simple, exactly. How many of you feel that the Christian life is simple?
No way.
Oh, no.
I'm going to repeat something that I've said to you many times, and I'm going to say it again. The Christian life is complicated and it's hard, and we can't do it except without God, with God's help. And one of the things, here's the part that I've said before, one of the things that ticks me off is when preachers make it harder than it's supposed to be.
They talk over their head.
Well, and the thing is, I've shared the one particular thing that I've shared with you in the past is prayer. When you listen to Jesus talk about prayer, what is prayer? It's talking to God. And one of the things that Jesus says is that if you talk to God, you can be sure he hears you. Now, that's talking to a Christian. I mean, somebody who's not saved shouldn't be talking to the Lord about, you know, all their activities of the day. They should be talking to him about forgiveness of sins, to trust him and put their faith in him. But once you put your faith in Christ, you know that you have a Father who loves you and cares about you, and when you talk to him, he hears you. And it really upsets me to hear some preachers make it so complicated that you feel like, I just haven't been doing it right. There must be something wrong with me. Can I just ask you, have you ever heard a little voice in your head say, there must be something wrong with me? I must not be doing it right. God just doesn't seem to be listening to me. I don't know what's wrong. It's just not working. And one of the things that I hope that I have communicated and can continue to communicate to this church effectively and to you as an individual is that the difficulty that we have in life is not because God is not listening to us, and it's not because he's holding something secretly against you. God's upset with you! Honestly, to listen to some preachers talk, you'd think that's how it was. And he's upset with me, but he's not telling me what. He's not telling me why. And I just want to say to you, that is a lie from Satan. Every time you sense that kind of a message in you, that is a lie from Satan that frankly sometimes preachers kind of feed into. Because all preachers, I hate to tell you this, all preachers have an agenda. Now right there, instead of saying amen, you're supposed to go,
you didn't get an amen.
Now, look around you. Part of my agenda, I'd like some folks to come to church. I'd like some more folks to come to church. I'd like some more visitors to be here.
Yes.
I'd like to see less blue.